Dear colleagues, it's well known that luminal cancer is the most common pathology of breast, and it accounts for 70% of all the tumors, and it accounts for great amount, and it's a heterogeneous process. It could be associated with good or bad prognosis, so it can even be similar to the triple negative cancer. If you look at such compilation of this individual treatment, then this high risk of relapse, and also it shows our evolution and our attitude in treatment. First of all, we actually took on board the chemotherapy in the high risk of relapse. Then we understood that chemotherapy and hormone therapy give us approximately the same prognosis. And we started using hormonal therapy more in metastatic breast cancer as well. The main and the most important is, first of all, to have high quality of life, good quality of life, and good long-term results, which we managed to do. But sooner or later, there is resistance which occurs in these patients, and we need to shift either to chemotherapy or stop treatment as such. But as there is an introduction of new drugs like the cyclin-dependent kinases, we managed to prolong the life of a standard hormonal therapy and actually bring our patients to the curable sort of subgroups. And there is resistance that occurs to the new drugs as well. And we need to study other solutions. And there are certain drugs like M2 and the P3K, PARP inhibitors. They are quite effective in the receptor-positive tumors. But sooner or later, we stumble over the resistance to any treatment, and we need to resort to the chemotherapy. But it's not a fact that it will be effective, and sometimes there is no elevated efficacy to the chemotherapy among these patients. Despite our success, we need to speak about toxicity, and we need to speak about the introduction of new drugs, which allow us to overcome the resistance to the hormonal therapy. For example, the toxicity is at a very low level, but sooner or later, toxicity is increased, and we will need to do something about it. These are the main reasons for unfavorable prognosis and the favorable course of the disease. This is primary or secondary resistance or endocrine resistance. Sometimes these are molecular characteristics, which we have learned relatively recently, and also the let's talk about adjuvant treatment. Hormonal therapy, tamoxifen, for example, improved survival rates approximately by 50%. But also, we know very well that, for example, in the triple negative or HER positive cancers, the relapse occurs within 5 years. In the receptor positive cancer, they occur over 5 years. So we have a question, what to be done? There is ATLAS study, which is prolonged treatment, additional 5 years of tamoxifen. And it shows improvement in the overall and relapse-free survival. Meta-analysis also shows improvement of both overall and relapse-free survival. So there was conducted. There were several other studies conducted, which also were targeted at the efficacy of letrozole, for example, or adjuvant treatment. 10 years and versus 5 years of therapy were compared, and also it showed improvement in relapse-free survival or disease-free survival. And the aromatase inhibitors, they proved to be more efficient than tamoxifen. Now, this is quite a big list of studies which have already been finalized. And here, I would like to say that we have here different combinations. This is tamoxifen to letrozole, then aromatase inhibitors after 5 years, And also the main conclusions were the following, that the prolonged hormonal therapy is determined in the by the menopausal status, and it should determine the treatment. It's either tamoxifen or we should move to the aromatase inhibitors with the ovarian suppression. But here we come across certain complications of this prolonged endocrinal therapy. In the aromatase inhibitors, you can see quite a big list of complications, and I suppose they are most significant. These are CVDs, exacerbation of CVDs, and also you can see fractures where you have the red circles or red ellipses. This means there is a surplus growth increase that resulted in halting of treatment or treatment interruption. And if compared to other types of treatment, they are still quite low. Now, when it comes to ovarian suppression in such patients, you can see that there were two trials, Soft and Text, and it was demonstrated that if you add ovarian suppression to tamoxifen and elvestan, then the most efficient is ovarian suppression to, added to the aromatase inhibitors. Now, the most effective group is our patients younger than 30 years of age, naive to this type of therapy. And also, such type of treatment is quite effective in patients who received chemotherapy previously and in the postmenopause. Pausal women. If you talk about hormonal therapy choice in Lumina breast cancer, of course, there exists a heterogenic group. This is a group of high risk and groups of low risk. And as the MDK-Taylor demonstrated, it's not clear actually what to give these patients, hormonal therapy or chemotherapy. You can see this is a study that showed that they're equally effective, but in patients of younger age, younger than 50, we suppose that chemotherapy should be administered because the survival relapse-free rate is much better, significantly better. This is MINDACT trial. You can see that MammaPrint was used here. Also, there is a group of intermediary type of prognosis, and it was shown that the chemotherapy in the common group is somewhat better in terms of the outcomes. But in the subgroup analysis, it turned out that in the younger patients, the disease-free survival is approximately 5%. This is quite significant. As a result, the authors came to the conclusion that they can propose the following treatment algorithms for patients with the intermediary prognosis. When it comes to the other types of prognosis improvement in the adjuvant treatment, there are several ongoing trials which are all devoted to the efficacy assessment of the ICDK 4 and 6. So this is the ribociclib, palbociclib, and amibociclib. So at the moment, these are an ongoing trials, and we are still waiting for their outcomes. I would like to say that, nonetheless, the Penelope B is not an adjuvant treatment per se. This is the post-neoadjuvant treatment. This is treatment which is widely known for HER-positive and triple-negative cancers. For the Catherine study, for example, which verified its efficacy of capecitabine and epidem and of the post-adjuvant treatment. So now we're going to wait and see what's whether it's going to be effective in other types of treatment. No adjuvant treatment. I'd like to say that it's quite an important aspect of the receptor-positive breast cancer treatment. So the hormonal therapy previously was not discussed. The chemotherapy was resorted to immediately. But as a result of such study, it was demonstrated that the hormonal therapy was actually used, and it gave better results. The same results came in terms of survival. There were trend towards better survival, although it was not statistically significant. But we needed actually it to be equal to the result of chemotherapy in the postmenopausal women. So for patients of more favorable prognosis, at the moment, we conducted quite a big number of different studies assessing the efficacy of the neoadjuvant hormonal therapy. As a matter of fact, these are comparison of aromatase inhibitors and tamoxifen. In a number of studies, it was proven that the aromatase inhibitors have their benefits, and organ sparing surgeries also were demonstrated as something beneficial. You can see here that one of the studies included three aromatase inhibitors, and also there were no difference in the survival rates and also number of organ sparing surgeries. And at the moment, we have a new spin of neoadjuvant treatment, the so-called test hormonal therapy, which allows us to assess efficacy of such treatment. What actually is done? The level of Ki-67 and its level really influences the level of local regional relapses. You can see this is the study stage. There was full-fledged hormonal therapy used, and also another trial, POETIC, which shows the true test hormonal therapy. Within the course of 2 weeks, it demonstrated the change of Ki-67 and how it influences the frequency of relapses. It either doesn't change if the Ki-67 doesn't change, and if the Ki-67 was high and never changed, then it remains very high. Apart from Ki-67, there is another index which is called PEPI, the preoperative endocrine prognostic index, which assesses the level of estrogen receptors as well. And if it is equal to zero, then the hormonal therapy will give us the figures of higher disease-free survival than if PEPI is from 1 to 3. So this is another study, CASOG, that which also showed that 10% of Ki-67 is also has prognostic value. If it is over 10%, then in 2-4% after biopsy, then it is associated with a poorer prognosis. The next study, Alternate, which actually was demonstrated, the results of which were reported this year at ASCO. There are three groups. The last one is in combination with fulvestrant. They were trying actually to assess the Ki-67 level, but there were no significant differences between the groups. Nonetheless, they managed to demonstrate that if the level of Ki-67 was low, then only in some parts it was elevated. In 100% of cases, it actually goes, it remains low or even is decreased. So that's why we don't need multiple biopsies to assess Ki-67 in this subgroup of patients. And also, if it was over 10%, then in the 4 weeks, it actually goes below 10%, which again reflected the efficacy of treatment. The long-term results are not there, and we are still waiting for them. So at the moment, there is another study ongoing, Umbrella, which also touches upon types of treatment, and the Oncotype DX is done to plan the treatment. It's either just hormonal therapy or additional chemotherapy. No results yet. In no adjuvant treatment, there are also other targeted, like PI3K and cycline-dependent kinases. And letrozole plus chemotherapy. We don't have any improvement of indicators here on the full morphological regress is not achieved, but there are improvements in the indicators in terms of the organ sparing surgeries, and also Ki-67 improvement is also there. Another study, Neopal, Neomenarch, and Pallet, they compare not with chemotherapy but with aromatase inhibitors, and the second group are aromatase inhibitors plus cyclin-dependent kinases. Ki-67 is reduced in all cases, and in two groups also there is full morphological regress. It's not big, but they achieved it. If you come to a short conclusion, then disregarding the fact that we do use chemotherapy for patients with low relapse rate, nowadays we still resort more frequently to hormonal therapy. And in the future, I suppose, we shall resort to hormonal therapy only. Further on, metastatic cancer, this is a very difficult group of processes. In the primary cancers, we have certain time limitations. In terms of systemic treatment, here we have none. And sooner or later, we have resistance to this or that medication. The quality of life goes down, and there is quite a big number of adverse events. And whether we should be shifting to the hormonal therapy for these population of patients, as yes, indeed, the hormonal therapy and endocrine therapy is not worse than chemotherapy. And if you have a balanced approach to choosing it, then this time to progression in hormonal therapy and in chemotherapy look identical. So there is a trend in metastatic cancer. If there is a chance, you can have at least three lines of hormonal therapy, and then you can continue thinking about some other types like chemotherapy or targeted therapy. But here we also have certain limitations. If you look at the number of randomized trials, if you compare the aromatase inhibitors and their effect, the median to disease-free survival is restricted to 1 year. And if you use fulvestrant, then it improves survival rate up to 15 months, and if there is no hormonal therapy, up to 16 months. But nonetheless, the biggest progress are the cyclin-dependent kinases inhibitors, which allow us to improve disease-free survival, and the ribociclib. All of them give us just twofold growth in survival, disease-free survival, both in the first and second lines of treatment. If you come to compare them with the traditional ones, then the survival rate will be much higher. Disregarding the fact that palbociclib was actually studied in the poor prognosis group, patients, the majority of them were hormone resistant. Unlike the first study and the Falcon, they even showed or demonstrated the relapse-free survival improvement. In patients with visceral metastasis, also improvement in survival. In fulvestrant, there is no improvement. And in palbociclib, you can see that there is evident improvement in disease-free survival. Apart from that, the cyclin-dependent kinases inhibitors, also they postpone chemotherapy to 3 years. This is a very good indicator both in the first and in the second line of treatment. Here you can see palbociclib with carbacetabine, which again shows that the aromatase inhibitors in terms of disease-free survival are better. Percival study, I'm not going to speak about it because it has already been demonstrated several times, and the comparison of two regimens. And here No difference in survival rates again. Unfortunately, toxicity is increased. Mainly, this is hematogenic type of toxicity. There are new drugs. There is new toxicity. Despite the fact that resistance develops, the effect of additional treatment is there. So what do we administer after that? For example, this is a PI3K, PI3K pathway, and the inhibitors of this signal pathway, they influence relapse-free survival in all patients negatively. But if we use drugs which are about inhibiting this pathway, then the survival rates are better. We're not speaking about overall survival. We're speaking about only the survival and where it is better. Then PARP inhibitors also proved to be effective. For example, talazoparib, there was a study which demonstrated disease-free survival if compared to the conventional treatment by doctor's choice. This is the last slide, which shows that all the drugs which are administered additionally to hormonal therapy, they are associated with adverse events. There are quite many, but this is not the spectrum which can be compared to chemotherapy. And I would like to say that they allow us to resort to hormonal therapy for a longer period of time, and disease-free survival is significantly improved, as well as the quality of life. Excuse me for speaking too long. Thank you very much.